Good morning. How's everybody doing today? Welcome to the house of the Lord. I am Pastor Don. Welcome to Destiny Church today, everybody in-house and everybody online. We at Destiny Church are a family of believers. We're loving God and His creation. We're learning to be followers of Christ through God's holy word, and we're living out our divine destiny through the leading of the Holy Spirit. Here we are loving, we're learning, and we're living, and I'm thankful that you are in this house, that you made the choice to be with us today for worship. Thankful for everybody online that is with us today and will be with us later in the week. We thank you for all that you do to support us and our church here. And well, I just want to share a few announcements with you. If you are guests of ours today, some ways you can connect with us, and also some things you may not be aware of, and also give you some things online how you can connect with us as well. Let's start in-house. First of all, we do have nursery today for ages zero or infant through 3 years old, and that's out these double doors here to your right. And go check them in this morning. We'll take care of them for you during service if you so desire. We do have children's church today for ages 4 through 12. So you're welcome to go out to the right of the building here in this corner. Check them in. We'll take care of them. They're going to learn the Word of God on their level today. They just started a new candy series, so they may be bringing some candy out after service and having that. They're learning about God through candy. Isn't that great? That sounds like something we might want to do in the adult sanctuary as I think about it as I'm announcing here, but we'll move on. We do receive tithes and offering. God has led us to do it this way. There's boxes in the doorways. You can leave it at any time you want to during the service. I'm going to pray over the offering in just a minute, ask the Lord to bless it. Thank you for all of you who are giving. We do have a special project going on in-house, which is a toddler nursery renovation project. The Lord has blessed us with over a dozen new births in the last 18 months or so, and so we're so thankful for that. We're expanding and preparing for that, but also believing that the new Roe versus Wade reversal is going to bring new children into the house, and so we're doing that. If you want to give to that, you can do that by earmarking that, marking that on your giving envelope in-house if you so desire. Online, you can give by going to our website, which is destinychurchms.org. For those of you already have our app, you can give through that. We're still working through some processes. If you're a new member trying to download that app and you have an Apple system, we're having to work something out. Hopefully I can get that done this week. Also, if you desire to connect with us online, you're welcome to email us at hello@destinychurchms.org. In-house, you can fill out a connection card. You can go to the Welcome Center, receive a folder that's got more information about our church in it. Also, there's a card there. You can leave it with someone at the Welcome Center. You can place it in these boxes I've already mentioned, or you can simply hand it to me on the way out of church today. Also, just a few events really quickly that I want to share with you. This is our bulletin. You can pick one of those up on the way out if you didn't already. I'm not going to cover everything in here. Please take that with you. There's a lot of events coming up. I'm going to hit some new ones that are coming up quickly for the month of September. Church membership on Sunday, September the 18th. We have several families looking to desire to become members. And so on Sunday, September the 18th, that will be the Sunday that we do that. If you desire to know more about that or get more information about that, you can see me or Teresa between now and then. Also, just want to remind everyone about our young adults meeting on Wednesday nights, and that is from 6 to 8 p.m. That is from middle school all the way through college age. They are learning the Word of God, fellowshipping from during that time. We have some things coming up on Wednesday night. We're a little delayed because we don't have all the volunteer system worked out yet, but we will be gathering together soon on Wednesday nights. Just not sure yet when. We've got some things in the works, so just know that that is coming. Also, Teresa's going to share with you about our ladies' ministry.
Yeah, Tuesday night, ladies, we get together again. We've had a break over the summer, so Tuesday night we're going to get together for some fellowship. We're going to have a salad supper. Now, I'm amazed at how many people have never attended a salad supper before. Now, garden salad, I'm going to make sure that that is covered. So all you have to do is bring some other kind of salad. It can be corn salad, tuna fish salad, chicken salad, broccoli salad.
Tater salad.
Yeah, any kind of salad. We're just going to have a good time of fellowship at 6 o'clock. We're going to have some fun time. We're about to start our Esther Bible study, so we're going to watch a movie on the life of Esther. So that all starts at 6 o'clock on Tuesday night, so come have fun with us.
Would you stand with me this morning? We're going to prepare our hearts to worship. We have several in our body that need physical healing today that are out, so we're going to pray for their healing in particular. And I know in a house today like this, with this many people here, there's a lot of needs in this place. And so I want you to cast your cares upon the Lord this morning as we begin to pray. Just pour out your heart and soul and mind. He knows what's going on with you today. And we are in his house. And therefore, as we begin to worship him, we're going to be in his presence. And I'm so thankful for that, because when we get into his presence, salvation can happen, healing, restoration, renewal, all the things that happen when we get into God's presence is going to happen today in this service. I believe that with all my heart. So online, get ready to prepare yourselves for worship as well. So let's just do that this morning. Let's cast our cares upon the Lord for the needs that we know about, for the things that are heavy on our hearts, for others that we may know about. And then, after we've cast our cares, let's get our hearts ready to worship. Let's do that together. Lord, we love you today. God, I thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit that is in this place and lives in me. I thank you, God, for the stripes of Jesus that can heal those that are sick in body. And Lord, I pray for healing in the mighty name of Jesus this morning. Lord, you healed people in these altars last week. We see the testimonies of it. We know that the best is even yet to come. And there'll be more healings in the house today. So we pray for spiritual, emotional, physical relationships to be healed, to be made whole and well. We need to pray for provision today for everyone that may need have needs that need to be met. And Lord, we pray for others today that we know that are broken, that are hurting, that are suffering. For a family that I know personally that's grieving today, Lord, I pray for your comfort in their lives and their hearts. And now, Lord, I'm going to sing a song that only we can sing as the redeemed of the Lord. The angels can't even sing this song. But as we begin to sing today about your salvation and about your grace and about your mercy and about your love, we know that our praise is going to inhabit the throne room of heaven, that angels are going to be stirred, that your heart is going to be likened unto us, and you're going to visit us today in this house. Lord, we thank you, God. I already feel your presence. I feel your encouragement. I feel your strength, and I feel your love. And let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let's give him praise before we begin to worship in this house today. Amen? The Lord is good. Amen.
Amen. Can you just surrender yourself to him right now? Whatever's going to happen in this place, we're just going to surrender it to him, because the number one thing, he is exalted. He is number one in this place. He is enthroned here. Lord, we lift you up. Do whatever you want to do, Lord.
Searching for, we want you and nothing more. Let your glory fill this place. We're alive in your presence.
Yes, we are.
It's your heart.
little intimidating, because sometimes we don't understand what that means. But that just means that we're surrendered to Him. Let Him take out whatever needs to be taken out and put in whatever needs to be put in. That's all that means. He is holy, and He desires to live in holy people. So right now we're going to remember what He did for us, and we're not going to go back there to that old life, to those old ways. We're going to surrender.
Joy, peace. stood before creation. Eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion. My soul now to stand. You stood before my failure.
just tell him that in your own way this morning? Would you just say that all I am, Lord, is yours? Let's just worship him together in the house today. This is an opportunity now, as we begin to end the singing portion of worship, to begin to just open our hearts and our souls and our minds. You may close your eyes and just focus on him if you so desire. You may look at the floor, you may raise your hands. Just focus on him. Focus on his love, his grace, his mercy. And give yourself unto him. Jesus said, come unto me, all you who are weary, burdened, heavy laden, and I'm going to give you rest. Would you just rest in him for just a few moments this morning? Let's tell him how much we love him today. Lord, we love you today. We thank you, God, for giving your son as a sacrifice for our sins and our shortcomings, that he gave his life so that we could be made right and reconciled unto you for right relationship with you. And Lord, because of the power of the resurrection, we can have freedom from those things that hold us back, freedom from our sin and our shame, freedom from our addictions and our pain. And God, we pray today unto you that your mighty presence, the wonderful gift of the Holy Spirit, would mend hearts and souls and minds in this place today. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's give him praise again before we're seated today. Amen. Amen. And you may be seated today. We're about to do one of my favorite things to do as a shepherd and a pastor, and that is dedicate a young one to the Lord. We're about to dedicate Titus James Taylor today to the Lord, and so I'm just putting his family and extended family, if you want to come on notice, you don't have to come right this second, but I'm putting you on notice because I know it takes a minute to get babies where they need to be and moving forward. I'm going to share a few things, and so any family or extended family that would love to come up here in just a moment, I'd love to have you. We'll put Titus front and center here in just a second, and all you guys can kind of be on either side of them here. On the sixth day of creation, God unveiled his plan for the family. He created a man to be a husband and a father. He created the woman to be a wife and a mother. Together, they should find fulfillment as marriage partners and share in the marvelous conception of life. Children are so much more than the insurance of the continuance of the human race or a particular family name. They are treasures of life given by God and intended to be a part of the family. Each child's genetic makeup determines a great number of characteristics. However, the variable in every child's life is the nurture he or she receives during the crucial development years. This begins with the family, but the circle extends to include friends, teachers, neighbors, and the church family. And so we are going to do that as a church family today. So James and Jenna and family, if you guys could come on up and stand in front today. And extended family, if you want to come, just come on and stand on either side. Let's put him front and center. James is going to sing to him. Keep him occupied and pacified. What a beautiful family. You guys come on. Wonderful. Awesome. James and Jenna, you're bringing Titus before this church body today as a public statement of your desire to be godly parents by following the practice of dedicating him to the Lord. Hey, big man. Through his birth, you already know this, your marriage will be both blessed and stretched, right? Yet the wonder of love is its ability to grow, to include one more without anybody receiving any less. It continues even in the time of fatigue and frustration. That's because love isn't just an emotion. It's an attitude, it's an action, and it's a choice. So James and Jenna, the dedication of a baby is really more of a dedication of you guys as parents to fulfill your role in developing Titus. For that reason, I'm going to ask you to respond to the following statements of commitment. In congregation, I'll just put you on notice. I'm going to ask you in a few moments to make some commitments as well. So James and Jenna, will you nurture your marriage so Titus can grow up in a home where mother and father demonstrate their love for each other and their children? If so, say we will. Will you pray for Titus's future even now so he will develop in an environment of prayer and support? If so, say we will. Will you take Titus to church and as well as personally teach him the truths of Scripture? If so, say we will. Will you, to the best of your ability, demonstrate to Titus what it means to live a life of following Christ and walking in the Spirit? If so, say we will. And finally, today for you guys, do you give Titus to the Lord for life service, however and wherever he chooses? If so, say we do. Now, congregation, if I could get you to stand with me today, our faith family, and everyone, if you so desire. No family raises a child in isolation. Children are impressionable and learn both good and bad from those around them, regardless of their age. Knowing the need for spiritual role models, will we as the body of Christ in this congregation faithfully serve this family and their child? If so, say we will. Will their physical child become our spiritual child? If so, say he will. Will we provide the opportunity for Titus to grow in an atmosphere of Christian support, spiritual worship, and biblical teaching? If so, say we will. And finally today, Destiny family, do you receive Titus James Taylor today as family in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? If so, say we do. You may be seated. I'm going to pray over you guys. I'm going to take Big Man, Big T, that's what I've been calling him lately. What a fine young man. You know, the name Titus means pleasing. He's pleasing to me. It also means good news. What good news God has given you, all of you. What a blessing. What a precious one. We're going to give him back unto the Lord because every good and perfect gift comes from him. And today we bless him for this gift. God, I pray for this young man today. I lay my hands upon him. Lord, as the shepherd of this house, and I ask you, Lord, to order his steps all of his days. May he come to know you at an early age, and may he never depart from you, God. May your Holy Spirit be a comfort and guidance to him his entire life. May his steps be ordered by you. May his choices be ordained by you. Father, we thank you for him. We thank you for all that he represents, every good and perfect thing, Lord. I thank you for the way that you have made him perfectly and wonderfully. Already, God, we begin to see his gifts and his talents and his unique personality. And, Lord, we thank you for all of them. I play a hedge of protection around him, Lord. I pray for your Holy Spirit to touch him in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to give him back. All right, I'm going to pray for mom and dad now. Lord, I pray for this father right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would touch him, God, that you would give him wisdom beyond his years. Lord, that everything that he is weak in, that you allow him to be strong. And Lord, I pray that others be surrounded by him to show him and lead him as a father and a husband. God, I thank you for him and the call that is upon his life. I thank you, God, that he has given him unto you. And I thank you, Lord, for his presence in this family and his position he has taken. God, I bless him today. I ask, Lord, that you bless everything he put his hands to. Let it prosper for your glory and your honor. And Lord, I pray for this precious mother today. Lord, I pray for peace of mind and peace of heart. Lord, I pray that you give her the confidence that only you can give, that you have given Titus to her. Therefore, you will equip her, that you will empower her, that you will ordain her to do everything that she needs to do as a mother. Lord, I pray that this marriage be strengthened through this birth. Lord, I pray for peace in this home and this life. And God, I pray for blessing upon blessing after blessing. May you go before them, may you stay behind them, and may everyone around them know that the favor of you is upon them. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. We have some gifts for you guys today. Got a little devotion for Mom. We got a Bible for Titus. I may have one more time. Can you let them know how much we appreciate them today? God is good. Let his mercy endure forever. Amen. Thank you so much for family for coming and supporting today. It means a lot. It's a great testament to this family and all the support you have. Thank you for coming. You guys may be seated. We're about to prepare our hearts for the word, and I'm going to pray in just a few moments for us to receive the word. You know, I don't think we thank him enough. I really don't. For those of you a few weeks ago, we talked about praying and how we hold our hands together, that we petition, we receive, we accept, and we act, and we yield. But also, the Apostle Paul says that we never pray without bringing thankfulness. And do you know a thankful heart cannot be bitter? Did you know a thankful heart cannot be anxious? So in your own way right now for this moment, how can you not be thankful? God has given us life. How can we not rejoice? For we're together as family, and we're doing things in the body of the Lord. Would you just give him thanks again before we go to the word this morning? Father, we thank you today. I thank you, God, for restoration. I thank you, God, for homecomings. I thank you, God, that we complete, and sometimes things just come full circle. I thank you for joy. I thank you for peace. I thank you for love. I thank you for grace. And I thank you, Lord, for this family. And I pray that all that need it would find it. And that all that love you, Lord, would love you even more. In Jesus' name, amen. This is life, right? Jesus came so that we could have life and life abundantly. John 10:10 says that he came so that we could have life and have it abundantly. If you look at the Amplified Version, which does what it says, it just amplifies the word. The Hebrew language is hundreds, if not thousands, of years older than our language that we have in English. And so it just expands on all of that time and all of those words that were created during that time. And it says, Jesus came to give, he told us to give life to the point of overflowing. And so if I ask all of us today, including myself, are we really living the good life? Many of us including myself, would begin to think about all the things that were wrong instead of all the things that were right. And so God has been walking us through as a church family about these things and the season that we're in, that he's adding to our fellowship, and that's going to happen and happen quickly. And so we need to prepare for that. We need to get ready for that. We need to be able to serve and be a part of the things that God is calling us to do. And so there's a season of healing. There's a season of deliverance. There's a season of restoration. There's also a season of growth. And there's a season that we can enter into as servants of the Lord, that we can really press past those things that so easily beset us. And we can, as he's been talking about the last few weeks, just embrace the light. And so today is one of those days that we're going to talk about that when good isn't good enough. And I'll explain that more in just a few moments. But would you just pray with me today? As normal, I have so many things going on in my mind, and I have so many things that I want to see happen, but I need to just get all of that out of the way and let the Lord do what he wants to do and let him explain it to you so you get it the way I've gotten it. So would you just stretch your hands this way and pray for me and with me today? Father, I have been reminded so much this morning that I preach, Lord, to save myself. I preach, God, because I love you. And I know that I need to decrease and have you increase. And I know, Lord, that you desire to do great things among us today. That to do great things in my life and others around me, Lord, that I simply need to surrender and be a vessel. That they don't see me, they see you. And so, Lord, you arrange this word the way that you desire. May it have the powerful effect that you want it to have. And, Lord, I've already been grieving over those that wouldn't hear it today as I was driving here, because I know the enemy kept some from doing that. And so, Lord, I pray that somehow, some way, this message finds them, not to bring any accolades or recognition to even this church, certainly not me, but that the word would do what we know what it says it will do, that we cast our bread upon the waters and it will not return void, that your word would change, that it would magnify, that it would divide, that it would heal, that it would restore, that it would save, that it would deliver, that it would inspire, that it would encourage, that it would set us free in Jesus' name. Amen. So, sometimes we say this saying a lot. I'm good, right? I'm thinking about a particular time when a few years ago that I was in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, at a retreat for some ministers in our state. I'm on the state council, and we were there for team building and mentoring and getting to know one another. Well, all of a sudden, we heard that there was a chance of snow. What did Don do? I went to the nearest Walgreens I could find, bought me a $7 sled, which is basically a big plastic bowl. And I said, if it snows, we're going to slide. We're on a mountain. I've dreamed of this since I was a kid. And I came back, and I was with a bunch of ministers, and they said, you have lost your mind. I got me one. I got Teresa one. We get out. Of course, videos are out by now. You know, everybody's got their cameras because they're like, hey, watch this. This wouldn't be good. We take a few little slides down into the driveway to the cabin where we are, get our nerve up, or at least I do. And so it's ice mostly. It's not even snow. And I decide that I'm going to slide down this mountain, down this drive. And I know that I don't need to go too far all the way, so I convince my leader, which is my state overseer, hey, you get about halfway down, and if I'm going too fast, you just grab me. And just snatch me off. Oh, this is a great plan already, isn't it? Right? And so I get on this thing, and I get my nerve up, and actually there's people all the way down. You know why? They're just going to watch this event take place, right? And so sure enough, I start. What I did not calculate and take into account, that thing is perfectly round. So about 6 feet into it, I turn around totally backwards. So by the time I get about a third down the mountain to the guy that's supposed to catch me, he just waves because I'm doing about 45 miles an hour. And shortly after that, I become airborne. Teresa, there's video evidence out there. You can find it. Teresa just begins to holler, "Oh, Jesus, oh, Jesus, oh, Jesus," on the video. And when I get airborne, I decide I'm old. This was a bad idea. You know how time suspends like that? And I better get as flat as I can to sustain this blow, because I know snow's about that deep. It's not going to help. And sure enough, when I landed, it knocked all the breath out of my body. And so my leader, fearless leader, who didn't catch me on the way by, comes and reaches down, and he says, "Are you okay?" And as soon as I can get enough breath, I say, "I'm good. I'm good." I wasn't good. How many times do we do that, right? "How you doing?" "Oh, I'm good." We even throw up our hands, don't we? "Oh, I'm good. It's all good." Knowing good and well, it ain't good. Or we do like we did yesterday, and Teresa called me and Hunter out. We're at a restaurant. They didn't explain the order right, and they bring Hunter fish with bones in it. Well, that's not going to work. And she comes by, "Is everything okay?" And Hunter and I immediately, "Oh, it's all good." And Teresa looks at us and says, "Y'all told a fib." But that's just kind of our habit, isn't it? Because we want to please people, and some of us really don't want people to know what's happening inside of us. And so I'm going to talk to you about a parable today when Jesus talked about a group of people that says, you know, what's good is just good enough. But with Jesus, can I just assure you that until he splits those skies, the best is yet to come? I mean, it really is. And so Jesus is always taking us to be more like him. He's taking us from good to great. He's taking us from death to life. He's taking us from unrighteousness to righteousness. And so that journey that we just saw in the video, that life is a life of pursuit. And so today I want to share that parable with you, and it's in Luke 5, verses 36 through 39. And I'll read the translation that really spoke to me a few years ago, how Jesus put it in this parable. I'll give you some context for this parable after we read the scripture. So Luke 5, 36, 39, in New American Standard, this is the 95 edition of that, says this: "And he was also telling them a parable," meaning Jesus. "No one tears a piece of cloth from a new garment and puts it on an old garment. Otherwise, he will both tear the new, and the piece from the new will not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, otherwise the new wine will burst the skins and it will be spilled out, and the skins will be ruined. But the new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. And no one, after drinking old wine, wishes for new, for he says the old is good enough." Amen to the word of the Lord. And can I just tell you today that Jesus didn't contradict himself. He was trying to help that group of people see that the old is truly not good enough. And so he gave this parable to a group of Pharisees who were trying to explain to him, "Hey, Jesus, you don't look and act like us. And you don't even look and act like your own disciples." Jesus had recently called Matthew from his tax collector booth and said, "Come and follow me." And I love one of the older versions of the time of Jesus when Matthew's sitting there and he's just sobbing and he's weeping while Jesus is teaching. And he looks at him and says, "Hey, come follow me." And he jumps up. And so Matthew throws a salvation party, if you will, later that afternoon. Well, Matthew doesn't know anybody, but who'd have thought it? It's because he's a who'd have thought it. You know what a who'd have thought it is? Who'd have thought that boy had ever turned out like that? And a tax collector was certainly that in this region and time, because tax collectors sold out their own people. They taxed the people. They told on their own brethren who wasn't collecting taxes. So he had in his mind a good life, but good wasn't good enough. And so Jesus eating with all of these people, these Pharisees, these rule followers, these man-made traditions that they had set up, said, "What are you doing eating among these tax collectors and eating among all of these people that are not unsavory, and your disciples, they're not fasting and they're not praying, and your John, your own follower who heralds for you, his disciples, they fast and they pray." And Jesus gave them this parable. He also said that the sick need a doctor, and those who think they're well don't. And so Jesus was giving this parable to say, you can't take that old life of Judaism. You can't take that old legalism. You've made all these extra rules to go along with the rules that my father made, which you couldn't keep those anyway. So how in the world would you ever add more? And I'm paraphrasing some, but that's what he was saying. You can't take the old life and mix it with the new, because Jesus came to make all things new. So today, I don't think it's that far of a stretch, and I just wanted to make sure you heard the context of the parable to say that about you and I as Gentiles. How can we take that old life, that old self, when Corinthians says that we are a new creation in Christ Jesus when we accept him? So how can we mix the old with the new? I would tell you today that I don't think we can. And when we do, we just walk around with a patch. And when we do, our old life can't contain the new life. And so both are wasted. And that when we don't pursue the Lord with all our heart, soul, and mind, we are signing ourselves up for pain, misery, dissatisfaction, and to be unstable in all of our ways. And so today, really quickly, let's look at patch, let's look at poor, and let's look at pursue. So Jesus said that nobody takes a brand new garment, cuts it out of that brand new garment, and puts it on this old garment over here, unless you live in 2022, and let's move on. Puts it on this new garment over here that's wore out, because the new is going to pull away from the old, and it's just not going to look right, okay? So, one, you ruin the new garment, and secondly, this is never going to work. But what I want to say to you today is that I am guilty of this. Most all of you are. I'm not condemning you or trying to say who you are today. But I'm saying this region and the calling of our church is to help people understand you need more of Jesus than just a patch. Hello? Because if you have just a patch, that's all you're going to have. I can go out here, we're in the buckle, probably the underbuckle of the Bible Belt, and I can go out here and ask somebody, do they know Jesus Christ? And most of them are going to say yes. Do you know him as Lord and Savior? Yes, I accepted him at VBS and blah, 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 blah. Whenever, they're going to tell me they attend a big church so that I won't know if they do or not. And they've got it all covered. But yet, if I ask that person, are you troubled? Are you sorrowful? Is your life a hot mess? They would probably say yes. But I would try to tell them that you need Jesus. No, I got Jesus. I got my patch. And that's what we've got to tell people. And again, if I can say this enough, I hope I do, because as I was driving here today being grieved over the people that wouldn't show, and I look out here and I am grieved over that because I believed it would have benefited them, I am telling you this is not a sermon of admonition. This is a sermon of invitation to pursue Jesus with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength so that he can cause the old to fall off of us, that we can be delivered from the sin that so easily besets us, and he can truly set us free. Because if not, we're going to look like we're just out here and got this old stuff on with this patch. And people are going to be like, what about the patch? Oh, I know Jesus. But if they looked at our Facebook post, it would be like two different people live there. The enemy is constantly trying to make us think that Jesus is not enough. Can I just tell you today the truth of the Word of God, that Jesus is enough? When he's all you have, you'll find out that he is all you need. He has come to give life, to give it to the fullest, to overcome these things that you and I are so easily beset by. This patch needs to be so much more than a patch. We need to take the old and give it away and take on the new, to take off the spirit of heaviness and put on the garment of praise, to put on the breastplate of righteousness, to say that I serve the Lord, as for me and my house. And when that other stuff comes, I shun it and I say, no, Satan, get behind me. I will not look. I will not listen. I will not partake of, because that is not for me. I have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. His honey is sweet. His love is pure, and his life is mine. If somebody could get a hold of that, the streets would be full of people going, look at my new clothes, instead of, hey, I got my patch. Why? Because the enemy doesn't want us to understand that we can have life and we can have it to the point of overflowing. If he can't have you, if you've given your heart to him and you've made him Savior, but you've not made him Lord, that's his next battle. Okay, I'm going to get them to get their ticket punched so they turn so they don't burn, but I'm never going to let them pursue all of that because I'm going to keep them distracted with all this old stuff. I'm going to remind them how depressed they are. I'm going to remind them how generational curses have them. I'm going to remind them of this. I'm going to remind them of that. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And can I just tell you that if you're just coming to church every now and then to get you a new patch so you can survive, you will never thrive. So many people come in for a quick fix. Hey, I need a Band-Aid. No, you need to be healed from the inside out. Hello. Did I just say hello? Let's move on. Oh, I came in today. I need treatment. Oh, I'm in lack. Oh, I'm broken. My marriage is a hot mess. Oh, hallelujah. I had a wonderful time in the Lord. I need provision. I need a new job. And we don't see you for 3 months because the blessings take place of the blesser. And I know this is strong today. Visiting family, I usually don't preach like this. But the truth will set us free. Maybe it's the suit. Who knows? Let's move on. I'm just telling you the truth. I want you to have abundant life. Again, this is not admonition. This is invitation. Jesus is saying, come to me. That is not for you anymore. That is nothing. You're just trying to get a quick fix. You want something easy when you're going to need to follow me. You're going to need to let that patch go. You're going to need to let all of that go and embrace this garment of love and grace and mercy. A quick patch is never going to work. Why? Because Jesus came to make all things new. The cross did so much more than just try to patch us up. Because then we're just this piece of patchwork, and people are confused by that. These Pharisees, they're the same way. They're worried more about if people see their patch or not. How religious they are. It's all about the outside and not about the inside. Okay? And we need to make sure that when we come to church that we know that we can be changed before we leave. But we also need to understand that that is just the beginning, that God has called us to walk a life every day that is pleasing unto him. And guess what? If I do something that's pleasing unto him, Jesus said that if I love him, I will obey his commandments. And so it's not should I do right, should I do wrong. It's not obey the rules or not obey the rules. It's embracing the love of Jesus Christ. The love is what sets us free, and I obey him because I know he loves me. His love inside of me compels me to obey him. When I worship him, when I find myself praying unto him, his spirit and love fills my life because I know that he has better for me than I could ever have in my own life, that I could ever have in my own self. And therefore, he tells me who I am to him. He tells me that I am his own. He tells me that I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. He tells me I'm more than a conqueror. He tells me that I am the most high because he is high in me. He tells me that there is no weapon formed against me going to prosper. He tells me that I am loved by him, and therefore I will be loved by all. He tells me the truth. If you're getting 2 hours of truth every 6 weeks, then what are you listening to the rest of the time? You're going to get wore down by the lies. You're going to get wore down by the perception because the enemy's going to come in like a flood and you're going to hold up your little patch and you're going to be drowned. Pursue him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's not about Facebook posts. It's not about a sticker on our window. Most of you wonder why I don't have a Destiny Church sticker on my window, because I drive horribly and I would be a bad witness. I am told I'm number one more than you would care to know because I don't pay attention. Jesus is my pilot, not my co-pilot. Therefore, that's how I make it through every day. But I'm just telling you, it's more than that. It's more than this outward. It's inside out. Do you understand? If I just made that confession with my mind and my heart and my soul have not caught up, then am I truly saved? Am I really bought by the blood of the Lamb? Has His love really entered my heart? And if you only know salvation as rules, can I just tell you, you don't know Jesus today? Jesus loves you. His love will set you free. It's so much more than a patch. It is the garment of life and salvation. It is being wrapped in love. This region needs to hear this word. So many of them are out there broken and hurting and undone, and they need to have peace. The power to save, heal, and deliver them is in the finished work of the cross. There's truly new life that's greater than the old one. And we ask Jesus to pour into our lives and consume us. So let's look at pour really quickly. Jesus says, no one takes this wine and pours it into old wineskins because it's going to burst and the skin's going to waste and it's going to leave all that to be lost, okay? So I accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and I'm beginning to try to fill this new life with all of the things that He wants to pour into me. If I try to hang on to that old life, it's going to burst. Why did old wineskins burst when you poured new wine into them? Because they were now rigid and brittle and old, and they couldn't expand. New wine ferments. It takes all of these gases and begins to swell and shrink, and so therefore that new skin needed to be there to expand and go. The old one can't take the new. And so many of us are confused, and we don't understand why things aren't going our way when we're trying to pour a new life into an old wineskin. We're trying to live like the world but love Jesus with all our hearts, and we feel His love. We've got all that love that I'm talking about, but that love is not changing our ways. And we wonder why our marriages are a mess. We wonder why we're having dysfunctional relationships, because we're not obeying the commandments of God. And therefore, the wages of sin are death. And therefore, you can't go out and live like the world and expect to reap heavenly fruits. It's ludicrous to think that way. It's foolishness. And so, when you're looking for relationship counseling and your relationship is not in covenant, it's not going to work. When you're praying for God to bless you and move you forward and give you provision, but you're not giving unto Him those things that are there, it's not going to work. And if He knows that you're going to leave Him for the things you're praying for, do you really think He'll give them to you? I'm Evangelist Don, apparently, today, thinking I'm leaving here as soon as I'm done. But I'm telling you the truth, and the truth is going to set all of you free. There ain't enough counseling hours in the world to fix something that you're living in sin about. It's just not. And I'm telling you, I've lived it, I fought it my whole life, and I'll fight it till I get to heaven. This flesh wants what it wants. But if you'll cry out to Jesus, every demon in hell will flee your house. If you allow a call upon the name of the Lord and you worship Him till you get some relief, I assure you those addictions will fall off of you. Why? Because the power of the resurrection bought at the price that will free you from any chain the devil ever had or ever will have or is ever going to have. The blood of Jesus and that sacrifice will set you free. So many times we're blaming the devil for what our own flesh wants. Oh, the devil won't leave me alone. No, I've done it before. Oh, Lord, I don't want to do this, and I don't want to do this now. So don't let the enemy tempt me today, right? Isn't that what we pray? Lead us not into temptation. Well, by the end of the day, I've not been led into temptation, and I go looking for it. Well, the problem's not the devil. The problem is me. I have not crucified this old flesh. I have not taken up righteousness. I have chosen an old life that was full of death and pain and brittleness, and I'm not allowing the Spirit of God to pour into me. And so the more I'm around God, the more I allow the things of God to consume my life, the more the darkness flees because it can't stand the light. A double-minded man or woman, they're unstable in all their ways, James 1:8 says. So I wonder why my life's a mess. I wonder why, oh, I'm going to church. Oh, I'm going over here to see this revival. I'm playing K-Love in my car, but yet you know deep down you're sinning. Conviction hits you. It's hitting you right now. It's hitting me right now. It's what it does. And embrace it. Embrace it and say, Lord, deliver me. Lord, consume me. Lord, take this out of my life. I know that it's causing me grief and sorrow. Because if I'm so caught up in me, how can anybody else ever see a life of overflowing that as soon as it starts getting good, I allow the devil to bust my life wide open? That cycle breaks a shepherd's heart, by the way. To just see that happen over and over and over. And I know the lie. And I know how convincing the devil is to try to make you think, oh, just go back. Oh, remember what that thing did you for you before? It'll do it again. No, it won't. It's going to take more of it. And it's just going to cause you to die. It's going to kill you. So don't do it. Make the choice. Just make the hard choice to say, I am not going to do that. I am no longer that person. I am a new creation in Christ. I am no longer Dirty Don. I am Dandy Don. And Dandy Don loves Jesus. And Dirty Don needs to die. And there needs to be a funeral every day for him. Not that we bring flowers, but we put our foot on his neck and say he is buried and dead in Jesus' name. I pray that you get a hold of this because it's going to set your life on fire. Don't worry. Don't be afraid. Just bring it all to Jesus. Just get it all to him. Throw it down and don't say thank you and leave. Embrace him with all your heart, soul, and mind and let his love consume you. Let him pour into you. Make that magnificent shift in your prayer life where you're no longer just asking him everything and telling him everything he needs to do. But that as you get through with all that, say, is there something I might do for you? Not my will, Lord, but your will be done. You really want peace in your heart. You really want to lay down at night where there's only you and God and you know how jacked up you are. Oh, mercy, I got to be careful. I just realized what I said. It's true, though, right? You lay down at night so broken, so hurting, so confused. So empty, so void. I remember when Dirty Don used to be alive, waking up thinking it was part of my activity from the night before, that I felt so empty, that I felt so broken. It was the Spirit of God crying out to me, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy and laden, and I'll give you rest, Don. Everything you're trying, everything you're doing, everything you're trying to be, everything you're trying to make people think you are is useless. It is garbage. Let me tell you who you are. Let me tell you who you can be. Let me fill you with life. I pray today that you get a hold of it. I pray today be a line in the sand for you, that you decide that you're going to expand, that you're going to have your life be where it can be expandable so Jesus can pour more of himself into you. And can I just tell you, it's going to be hard. It's going to be a stretch. It's easier to be okay with good and not let God prepare us for great. That's really true. That's what that flesh wants. But we get complacent and we want it easy and we want it convenient. Isn't that what your prayer sounds like? It's what my prayer sounds like. I want it comfortable. And when it gets tough, I say, nah, that old wine, it's good enough. But can I tell you, we got to make the transition, church. It's not good enough, but God is enough. God is enough. When we pursue him with all we have, it's going to be worth it. We're going to give our whole life to him and prepare us for this next step that he's got us to do. Let's look at pursue. So many people limping around looking for their next patch, looking for a Band-Aid to stop the bleeding, looking for a quick fix. When God's trying to tell them, you belong to me. Looking for treatment when Jesus is the cure. Jesus can make all things new. When we pursue him with all of our hearts, it's amazing what happens. When we truly let him in on everything that's going on, I assure you, the darkness has to flee. And I assure you, that when you get full, you're not going to be only a hearer of the word, but you're going to be a doer of the word. Because the Holy Spirit inside of you is going to lead you to paths of righteousness. The Holy Spirit inside of you is going to say, don't look at that. Don't do that. Do this. Listen. This is just me, so let me talk about me. So, old life, old music, all that kind of stuff, right? So, I remember turning my life around, going down the road, listening to George Strait tell me all his exes lived in Texas. That's why he hung his tat in Tennessee. Reba singing that somebody should leave, but you need the kids, and they need me. And it was just like Matthew came up and shook me in that cab of that truck. This is Matthew. Hey, what are you doing? That's garbage. What do you think is putting in your mind? What do you think's happening to you? Where are you going in your mind? What are you thinking about? What are you saying? Oh, yeah, I remember that old life. Garbage! I'm yelling, aren't I? I apologize. The Holy Spirit will guide, lead, direct, educate, comfort, heal, restore. He is all things Jesus because he is the Spirit of Jesus and he is the Spirit of God all at the same time. Draw close to him and he will draw close to you. If you hunger and thirst for righteousness, Matthew 6:5 says, you shall be filled. It's not a devil problem. It's not, church, he's defeated. It's an us problem. It's this old flesh. It is dirty down. And he needs to go. He has to go. He's bitter. He's a woe is me. Always saying that nobody loves him, everybody hates him, he thinks he eat a worm. He's nothing but negativity. He's nothing but worried about what everybody can do for him and how much he's already done for everybody else. He's got to die. Whoever that is for you has to die because the new has come. And the more I pursue him, the more I become like him. The more that I step into this new life, the more I am no longer a baby just asking for milk, and my prayers don't sound like it's a toddler. It sounds like it's a child that is moving forward in daddy's business, which is the kingdom of heaven, to do the things that he's called me to do, to move from good is enough to God is enough. And I promise today, he is enough. We can be made whole by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. When we get serious about pursuing Jesus, others are going to see that in our life. They're going to see that it's not just a patch. They're going to see it is an entirely new life. That darkness is not staying anymore, that the light has come. Jesus came to make all things new. If we pursue him with all our hearts, the power of the resurrection will set us free. We got to go from good is not good enough to God is enough. And so without getting too far in the weeds today, this thought hit me this week. It makes perfect sense to say the old wine's better than the new. In my mind, now, the new wine, it's not fermented. The new wine's not going to give me the feeling I want the old wine to give me. And Jesus is sitting there telling those Pharisees, you've settled when I have so much more. I'm telling everyone in this house today, please don't settle. Never settle. Never settle. Look at this place today. You watch it every week from now on. Don't settle. You move forward in the name of Jesus. Good is never good enough with Jesus. He's always got more. He said, I am the new wine. I am life and I am love. That old wine's going to last about that long. And it's going to cost you everything. But this one, it's going to cost you your life. but it's free unto you. Salvation costs you nothing. Discipleship's going to cost you everything. You got to surrender. You got to give your life unto him. As the praise team comes, I want you to think about Matthew today. Matthew's sitting there. No doubt he's got a good life. Tax collectors were rich. I mean, he threw a party. It was a big one, too. But he's sitting there at that booth, and Jesus began to speak the truth. He began to tell everything that he was and everything he was about. And I don't know what Matthew was thinking. Maybe Matthew was thinking, you know what? I got a pretty good life, but there's something inside of me that's not working. There's something here that's not right. Or maybe Matthew was so convicted about his life that he done decided that all of that rich stuff was nothing. You believe that's true? We see it every day from the people that have the most take their lives because they believe they have nothing. So maybe he's sitting there and going, I got all this stuff, but it's nothing. I see the truth and it's before me, but I know I'm not good enough. I know that I'm not good enough. Jesus stretches his hand and says, come on, Matthew. Come on, son. Follow me. And he didn't hesitate. He didn't wait for the altar call to get just right. He didn't wait till next week. He didn't wait till he cleaned his life up. He got up. And he said, I'm going. And he said, the fact that you've done this, we're throwing a party today. Can I tell you that there's more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that comes home than 99 righteous? I want angels to throw a party every week in this place. They used to. They will again. Why? Because I'm not settled. And I don't want you to settle either. This is not admonition. This is an invitation. This is an invitation to pursue everything that God has for you, to let that old stuff finally go. Jesus can set you free. That thing doesn't have a hold of you. Listen to me. You are not an old sinner saved by grace. You are a new creation in Jesus Christ. That's a lie from the pit of hell. That's not in the Bible. Oh, I'm just no addict. No, you're not. You're a redeemed child of the King. You never were meant to be that way, and Jesus gave his life for you not to say you're that anymore. Well, I'm just a product of divorce. I've been my whole life. No, you're not. You're whatever Jesus says you are. Pursue him with all your life. Stop that self-condemnation. Stop that self-talk and listen to Jesus and let him tell you who you are. Would there be anybody in the house today that would say, you know what? I hear Jesus call. I hear him say, follow me. I hear him calling me past my junk, past my compromise, past my gray, past my, I want to see how far I can get out here and still make it. Heaven's going to be miserable for you because you can get to the place where you just want to see the King. Oh, to see him, to look upon his face. His beauty and his grace and his majesty and his love. And that's okay if you don't feel it. I'm about to finish. You can get out of here. I've been just where you are, waiting. If he'd just shut up, I'll get out of here and I'll run. But he's pursuing you. And if you don't feel nothing, hey, that's between you and him. But if you do, embrace it. Embrace it. I'm going to make it easy again today. Lord just said to do that. Online, I love you today. I'm thankful you're here. I'm thankful that you're a part of this. I'm fixing to pray with our online church, and then we're going to pray in this house. I'm going to dismiss you in just a minute. Let's pray together. If you feel the Lord calling you today, you feel him calling you, you feel his hand reaching out to you. I don't care if you see this 1,000 years from now. You found this for a reason. He's calling you right now. Accept his love, his grace, his mercy. Receive him as Lord and Savior. Embrace all that he has. Renounce all that you were. And be born again in the name of Jesus. I pray if you made that choice today that you email us at hello@destinychurchms.org. We have a mission of the message. It's just something simple that we can keep our minds around this so we can apply it this week. The message of the mission today, or the mission of the message, is I will pursue the Lord with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And He will make all things new. Amen. I love you and God bless. Now in house today, I don't want anybody concerned about who sees who at the altar. This place is sealed by the blood of the Lamb. You can make an altar where you are. It doesn't matter to me. But I believe salvation's here today. I believe restoration for somebody's here today. And I believe somebody's finally going to let go of all that junk and you're going to pursue. I believe today will be a day that you can go back and mark the line. Today is the day that I turned to the light and I didn't look back anymore.